Good morning. Welcome to the parish community of St. Francis of Assisi. In the presence of the resurrected Christ, let us praise God, singing hymn number 209. Come, ye thankful people, come. Number 209. Please stand.
Good morning. Special welcome to all of you, the community of St. Francis. And we continue our celebration, as always, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Today, Jesus challenges us, reminding us that we have to practice what we preach, both in the public forum and when we are alone by ourselves where no one knows who we are or what we are. We take a moment to recognize that sometimes our expressions of faith are inconsistent, and we ask for God's mercy and God's forgiveness and for a change of heart. And so we pray. Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd who goes after the lost sheep. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you are the light that helps the blind to see. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the word made flesh that helped the deaf to hear. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on all of us, forgive all of our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-loving God, by whose gift your faithful offer you right and praiseworthy service, grant, we pray, that we may hasten without stumbling to receive the many things that you promise as we seek to bring about your kingdom here on earth. We make this prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Malachi. A great king am I, says the Lord of hosts, and my name will be feared among the nations. And now, O priests, this commandment is for you. If you do not listen, if you do not lay it to heart, to give glory to my name, says the Lord of hosts, I will send a curse upon you, and of your blessing I will make a curse. You have turned aside from the way and have caused many to falter by your instruction. You have made void the covenant of Levi, says the Lord of hosts. I, therefore, have made you contemptible and base before all the people. Since you do not keep my ways, but show partiality in your decisions. Have we not all the one Father? Has not the one God created us? Why then do we break faith with one another, violating the covenant of our fathers? The word of the Lord.
Our psalm is number 335, Taste and See.
Taste and see.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Brothers and sisters, we were gentle among you as a nursing mother cares for her children. With such affection for you, we were determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our very selves as well. So dearly beloved had you become to us. You recall, brothers and sisters, our toil and drudgery, working night and day in order not to burden any of you. We proclaimed to you the gospel of God. And for this reason, we too give thanks to God unceasingly, that in receiving the word of God from hearing us, you received not a human word, but, as it truly is, the word of God, which is now at work in you who believe. The word of the Lord.
My friends, the Lord be with you.
Amen.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus told the crowds and his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees have succeeded Moses as teachers. Therefore, do everything and observe everything that they tell you, but do not follow their example. Their words are bold, but their deeds are few. They bind up heavy loads, hard to carry, to lay on other men's shoulders, while they themselves will not lift a finger to budge them. All their works are performed to be seen. They widen their plectories and wear huge tassels. They are fond of places of honor at banquets, and the front seats in the synagogues, of marks of respect in public, and of being called rabbi. As to you, avoid the title rabbi. Who among you is your teacher? The rest are learners. Do not call anyone on earth your father. Only one is your father, the one in heaven. Avoid being called teachers. Only one is your teacher, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be the one who serves the rest. Whoever exalts himself shall be humbled, and whoever humbles himself shall be exalted." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
Well, again, a special good morning to all of you here at St. Francis. Well, I think it would seem pretty evident that both Malachi and Jesus, if you didn't know better, were almost coming from a leadership conference. A leadership conference that was targeting the hypocrisy of religious leaders. Both of them decry the situation, and it's almost as if you could use those words and apply them very much today to especially the standing of religious leaders, not just within the Catholic Church, but across the board, where, again, the public display of behavior is rather contrary to their personal lives in a way that is very hypocritical and that leaves many of the faithful rather lost. And again, we come to see this is nothing really new, but it's probably something that's been going on for the last 2,000 years. And of course, both Malachi and Jesus have a different way of describing not only the hypocrisy, but the true meaning of what greatness and living a life that is religious in a way that is one of integrity and inspiring to others. Needless to say, of course, we recognize that it's not just religious leaders. Many of us could probably call attention to other people, whether they are political leaders, corporate leaders, community leaders, athletes, movie stars, whom we have been inspired by, whom we very much liked and aligned ourselves with, the values that we believe they held. But circumstances came about where they revealed their true humanity, they fell from grace, made some foolish decisions, and we were left kind of wandering, dismayed, lacking a sense of trust, and almost wondering what real good can be found in many of the people whom we'd like to hold up and admire and emulate. And yet, we also recognize that Jesus challenges his listeners with regard to how greatness is defined. We know that when we fall into the hallmarks of society, greatness is usually defined in terms of, you know, how much money you have in your money market account, the number of homes or cars, material possessions that you have, how beautiful you are, the number of college degrees that you have. And yet, in many instances, we come to see most of the time these examples fall rather flat. And we know that a lot of people that have a lot of these things in terms of greatness, we would question and be rather skeptical. And yet Jesus provides a different example of greatness that leaves his listeners kind of scratching their head and reconsidering what it really means. And I think for myself as a religious, I came to learn some of these truths that Jesus and Malachi are talking about. And I'm reminded that when I entered the Friar some 32 years ago, after our first year, we received our habits. It was a very meaningful celebration. It was private. We had another friar who helped us be garbed. And I remember one of the friars in formation saying to us, "Remember, it is not the habit who makes the friar, but rather it is the friar who makes the habit." I didn't really quite understand exactly what he meant by that, but when you put on the habit, something that had an 800-year tradition, something that for many people, it was something to be revered and respected, you were kind of in this new position when you were in the public arena and you were wearing this garb that came from the Middle Ages and, you know, affiliated with St. Francis of Assisi. And of course, you now had a new role within the community and especially within the church community. And it took a while, of course, to kind of figure out what exactly did that mean. And you had this garment on that was very symbolic and powerful, but it was also very humbling as you attempted to kind of understand the significance of what it really meant. And I remember really coming to understand what that friar said to us probably about a month after we had received it. I was driving with some of my other brother friars, my classmates, in our van, and we were coming from some kind of a church service. We were all wearing our habits, and there was construction, and we were in downtown Boston, and there was construction going on, and of course the light overhead was turning green, but there was nothing I could do because the construction was taking place, so couldn't move. But the cars behind me couldn't see that, so they started beeping. Well, of course, then the light turns red again, then it turns green, and I still couldn't move, but the cars start beeping. And so I kind of throw my hands up and I'm, you know, kind of making expressions to the mirror. Again, it turns red and then it turns green. Couldn't do anything. And people are beeping and I said, that's it. Put my car in park and I get out of the van. Of course, I'm wearing my habit. And I'm like, what do you want me to do? You can't move. And the guy that was driving directly behind me blesses himself and they all kind of are laughing. Again, I was reminded of this garment that I was wearing. It spoke volumes in ways that I really wasn't aware of. However, it wasn't until that summer, again, I recognized another part of the meaning of my religious habit. And that as a friar, I was a friar not only wearing the habit, but when I wasn't wearing the habit. And I had the privilege and the honor of working at our soup kitchen in Philadelphia, right where Rocky was made. And we probably served about 300, 400 homeless people every day. And there, I had the fortune of working alongside Father Hugh Hines, the former president of Siena College. He was a revered man who had served the college for over 20 years. He had done great things at Siena, extremely well educated. But the beauty of Hugh Hines was in his position at Siena College. He did great things to make the school better. He had to really align himself with some very powerful and influential people. But now here he was, you know, in his Madras shorts and black socks and an old t-shirt, standing in line with the homeless people, you know, taking their tickets. And he really was a very revered man with many of the homeless people as well. But his position as a friar was very evident in that he was being a servant in a way that was very humble, that wasn't wearing who he was or what he was on his sleeve. You would never know the great position that he had held and the degrees that he had just by looking at him in this different context of Philadelphia, but it was very admirable and inspirational. Fortunately, I had many other friars who revealed to me again, the true meaning of what it meant to be a friar, both wearing the habit in public and not wearing the habit, and in terms of how they live their life as lesser brothers and define the meaning of greatness. Again, we are reminded that greatness, all of us probably define differently, but Jesus provides us with an example today that is quite challenging, to say the least. And it invites us to kind of consider our life of faith, not only in the public arena, but when we are outside of the public arena, when we are in our own personal context where people don't know who we are or what we are. And we are reminded, how do we live our faith with a sense of integrity in a way that is an inspiration to other people and that defines greatness in the way that Jesus invites us to consider? May God's peace and all that is good be with all of us as we consider this challenge that sits before us. And together we stand in one voice and one heart as we profess our creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We now bring our own prayers and our needs and our hopes before the Lord, and our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church in all her members to use the gospel and church traditions to lighten the burdens of people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the gift of humility in our clerical and lay church leadership, to avoid the clericalism that does not serve the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Spirit to move hearts to bring an end to the wars that are destroying the lives of people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the security of the hostages held by Hamas and for their families, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For humility within nations that use military and economic power to oppress peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people who have left the church due to infidelity of the few, to realize and be open to the integrity of the many, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For people who are weighed down by the burden of age, sickness, and poverty, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For hope for all who mourn and eternal life for our dead in Christ, including Richard Roseberger, John Callert, William Roselle Jr., Thomas and Jane Lemmy, Agostino and Jeanette Carioto, Patsy and Francis Serafino, Jerry Lambert, Maria Caricari, and George A. Payne, Jr. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people and situations that we hold deep in our hearts and bring to this holy table, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Gracious and loving God, we ask that you continue to pour forth your Spirit upon all of us gathered here. Dispel the darkness of our hearts and of our world. Grant that we may always have a correct faith and a certain hope and a perfect charity as we seek to carry out your holy and true command. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As we prepare the Lord's table and ourselves to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, let us join in singing hymn number 505, Only This I Want, number 505.
Only this I want.
Pray, my friends, that this, our sacrifice, will be acceptable to our good and loving God. Good and gracious God, on this holy day, we ask that you accept the special gifts that we bring to your table, the gifts of bread and wine and the gifts of our lives. May they always be pleasing to you. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. My friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty and ever-loving God. For you have laid the foundations of all the world. You have arranged for the changing of times and seasons. You formed humanity in your own image and likeness, and set us over the whole world and all its wonder, to guide in your name over all that you have made, and forever to praise your mighty works, through Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. And so with all the angels and the saints, we praise you. And in a joyful celebration, together we acclaim. Lord, you are holy indeed, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending forth your Spirit upon them, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread into his sacred hands. He blessed it and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper had ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. We pour it forth for you and for all people, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." Mystery of Faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. We give you thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, and all your holy people your Son has gained for you. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on all of us, we pray, that together with Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles, the martyrs, St. Francis of Assisi, and all the saints on whose constant intercession we rely for help. And we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in union with the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Now, together as one family of faith, we join our voices and our hearts, and together we pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, for you live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
My friends, may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Let us now share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Friends, behold. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold the one who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Thank you. Gracious and loving God, may this holy food that we have received of the body and blood of Jesus Christ enlighten us in mind and heart to grow in wisdom and grace as we seek to present to the world that we are faithful followers of Jesus Christ in word and deed. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I don't believe there are any announcements, so I think that's a good thing. So the Lord be with you. Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. May the blessings of Almighty God be upon us, bringing us a sense of peace and hope and all that is good. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, our celebration has ended, but our lives continue. Let us go in peace to love God and to serve each other. Have a wonderful day, rest of the day, and a great week ahead. Stay safe, and thank you for coming.
Let us go forth singing hymn number 390, City of God, number 390.